Let's talk about radical substitution of alkanes. So we can form alkyl halides, monosubstituted alkyl halides, from alkanes in the presence of molecular chlorine and bromine under UV radiation. We're going to represent the photons of that radiation by the photon energy formula here, E equals Planck's constant times the frequency of light. So we'll use that little h nu as our indication that we're using this radical initiator UV irradiation, all right? So let's talk about bromination versus chlorination. So if we want the more substituted or the most substituted possible alkyl halide, we're going to want to go with bromination. And so if we look, this compound here, 2-methylbutane or isopentane, either one, has two equivalent methyl groups, a methyl group that's not the same as the others here symmetrically, a tertiary hydrogen here, CH, at that branch point, and then a CH2 group as well. So we can make up to four constitutional isomers from halogenation here. So with that many options, it's best to go with bromination to the more substituted position synthetically, and so we would get the major product substituted at the tertiary position. The degree to which that substitution occurs is based on probability of a substitution. And so we will see that with a tertiary hydrogen like C, three other carbon groups attached to that position, so right there, the probability is going to be 1,600 times or thereabouts, a good average that our textbook uses, times more likely than a primary. A secondary carbon substitution like D here is going to be 82 times more likely or thereabouts. And then finally, primary carbons like A and B are going to be our reference, our slowest substitution. And that has to do with the stability and rate of forming of each of those tertiary, secondary, and primary radicals. So for example, if we take the odds of substituting that C position, the tertiary position, we take the number of hydrogens, so there's one tertiary hydrogen of that type, we multiply it by its probability number, 1600 to 1. Then we divide by all the possibilities. And so we have this possibility of substituting position A. There are six 2CH3s that we can substitute of that type A times a 1-to-1 odds for a primary position. We add those to the three hydrogens of type B. They're also primary, so the odds number is 1. Add that to our tertiary that we just found was one hydrogen at 1600 to 1 odds. And then finally, there are two of type D that are secondary, so they're 82 to 1 odds. To get a percentage, though, part over the whole times 100. So we're going to punch that in the calculator here, 1600 divided by this sum of 6 plus 3 plus 1600 plus 82 times 2. And we get a product percentage when we multiply by 100 of 90%, or 90.2% of the major product. And so we can repeat that calculation by subbing out the numerator for any of our four different types of compounds here. Okay, so we can definitely do that calculation for all of them, but with bromination, it's a major product that's highly specific to that tertiary position, and so we just assume a 10% byproduct rate for this reaction. Okay, all right, looking at chlorination, when is it most useful? Well, when there's a high degree of symmetry in the compound, it will dictate a particular substitution, particularly when the less substituted position is required or desired. And so here we have a compound that has 1, 2, and 3 equivalent methyl groups, so 9 hydrogens of type A times a 1-to-1 probability Then we can take those 9 and get the total probability with this tertiary position here. And so what's our substitution rate? Well, for halides of chlorination, the odds of substitution for a tertiary are 5-1, for a secondary, 3.8-1, for a primary, again, our slowest reaction substitution is 1-1. So here with that tertiary, we'd have 1 hydrogen times a probability rate of 5, all of this times 100. So ultimately 9 over 14 times 100, and we can punch that in and get 64% of product A here, the major product that we've looked at. The balance would then be the substitution at position B, since there's only 2 types of protons. So not as specific, but it does give us a major product with this high degree of symmetry. There will still be a mixture of the two in the final product mixture. Okay, so because of this, we've got some concerns about selectivity, and it turns out the reaction is not stereoselective, and at times it can result in a large number of products. Now, this is a good example of when chlorination is appropriate, because only one product is observed. All right, so this is a good reaction. We could do this with chlorination or bromination, because substitution at any of these 6 positions, there are 12 total hydrogens that are all equivalent. They all give us the same product when we substitute them, and this is not a chiral center, and so no stereoisomers are produced. So very high yielding process for chlorination of this cyclic symmetrical cyclohexane here. Now we can take the same compound that we looked at a moment ago with bromination being a highly specific reaction. Turns out chlorination not so much. So if we look at the different positions we can substitute, and go ahead and draw all those in, we come up with those 4 constitutional isomers that we were looking at a moment ago. Okay, so substitute position, what do we say? A, B, C, and D. Well, it turns out in 2 of those structures, we created a chiral center. And so for each of those, we have equal amounts of 2 stereoisomers that form. And so we have to consider both R and S isomers because those 2 stereoisomers were formed, or 2 chiral centers form upon reaction with chlorine. Okay, this one's a little tricky to see, because you don't create the chiral center on the carbon where the chlorine is. It's remote, it's off by 1 methyl group. But substituting either of those methyls gives a different product from a stereochemistry perspective. Within those, you'll have equal amounts of R and S for each one of these products, but a total of 6 different products, including stereoisomers. And then we have this beast, halogenation of this methyl cyclohexane, okay? And actually, let me change that to cyclopentane here, as I've prepared for you an example in ChemDraw. All right, so right now, we've got a halogenation that looks simple, all right, but if we look, it's really not, because this is not a planar methyl. It's not a chiral center yet until we halogenate, and let's have a look at what it actually looks like. Okay, so it's got this methyl group here, but at the microscopic level, that methyl has to pick a side. Okay, it's either up or down, so either down here or up. We can draw it either way, both are correct. And so if we do that, and we consider it as being one way or the other, substitution at the ring now, all of a sudden this product would be different than this, and to a certain degree it really complicates our product mixture. Even though we would only get 1, 2, 3, and 4 constitutional isomers, if we consider stereochemistry, we get 10. And so let's have a look at that. From our reference compound, our original alkane here, we see that we've got All these positions we can substitute. Let's have a look at what that looks like. So substituting one of the first two positions here, I don't get stereoisomers. I get this primary position and a tertiary position that do not create a chiral center. But on the ring, substituting either side, forward and back, gives me four, or gives me different stereocenters that are created, two different ones in each example. So again, I create one and two chiral centers from none. There are two to the two possible stereoisomers, there's no selectivity, and all four stereoisomers form from that constitutional isomer. Same with when we substitute the three position, we have four possible isomers. Backing out, so we can highlight everything, convert the structures to names, and you'll see that we go from having no chiral centers, no stereochemistry, to now all of a sudden SSRR, RSSR, four possible stereoisomers. They are all different compounds. Okay, so we can check our work in that way. All right, looking at the mechanism of this beast. For any radical reaction, we have three steps: initiation, propagation, and termination. So for these, we'll use chlorination as an example. It works the same for bromination. UV light causes one electron to go to each chlorine atom. That's a homolytic cleavage. And it forms two radicals from none. Two chlorine radicals. The propagation step is going to exchange one radical for another. So we take our chlorine radical that we formed, and we're going to use the propagation step that gets us closer to our desired product. So the major product substitutes one of these primary positions. So that's the position I'm going to show receiving the new radical from this propagation step. So we have a homolytic cleavage of the CH bond to form an HCl molecule with one radical left over. So three half arrows forms HCl byproduct, and we form our new primary radical. All possibilities are happening. We only need to show the one that leads us toward the major product. They're all happening to some degree. And then finally, termination will show the step that leads directly to our product. That primary radical, two radicals join, two half arrows to form a new bond. Two radicals become none, and we have our major product.